minutes of somebody.
What is that?
This is our Bitcoin, $50 worth of Bitcoin raffle. Everybody who volunteers for at least 2 hours at registration gets a ticket.
Did we lose one?
No, I don't think so. All
right, pick somebody randomly to grab.
All right, somebody, Mr. Weeks. You got a name in there.
Trying for what?
This person wins $50 worth of Bitcoin for register or volunteering at registration. Dave Driscoll is not here, but we'll get it to him.
There you go, Dave.
Does he have to be here to get his Bitcoin?
I don't think so. Why, did he leave already?
He
just left?
No.
Oh.
Yes, that's right.
He does not need to be here to get his Bitcoin. No. All right, Dave wins.
Let's go ahead and get the wrap-up started. Mike? So this is the first time we've, Mike, we're starting.
We're doing this transaction, sorry.
You can do that when you don't have an audience waiting for you.
For us, are we?
Do you want us up there? What are you doing?
Yeah, why don't you guys all come up? Just we're all participating.
Does anyone have a pen? Oh,
I don't
care. There's already a chair up there. So this is actually the first time we've ever done a wrap-up for the Fest Week. We thought we would get together with you guys and see what your thoughts were. What did you like? What did you think could use improvement? What would you like to see done differently? And what would you like to see more of? So this is going to be kind of an interactive get-together that we're having. I would like to still get people on the microphone, so maybe I will put one here and you guys can come up.
Feels good that we're up here.
Yeah, we were coming up here.
Oh, well, it was Jeff deciding to get up here, so.
What? You asked us to come up.
Jeff's
yes.
All right, it was me.
First off, I want to thank everybody that has come, that's contributed, every single person. I feel like, I'm not speaking for the group, but for myself as an individual, I appreciate every single person that shows up, that takes part in anything, right? Not a volunteering thing, just a being here, like hanging out at a campfire, I value that. Being a part of the discussions, all of these things add to it. So it's every single piece of it that adds to the fabric of what we have going on here, that adds to the community, and that's huge. And I just love that. And you know, people bring new people, or new people hear about it, and just keep building. And we have more and more little kids running around, and this is awesome. So I'm thankful. I get a lot out of being here, and I'm really glad that we have such great participation. So thanks, guys.
Well, really what we're here is to get feedback from you guys. I mean, what do people think went good? What do you think people went bad? My major concern this year is, maybe for next year actually, is simplifying the payments. I think there was some confusion about different people paying different amounts and the whys and the what have yous. I think if we could streamline that, that would be incredibly helpful. But otherwise, yeah, I had a great time. This is an awesome fest. It's been a success, both in the amount of fun and the amount of funds that we've raised. We're definitely going to be able to throw another one next year. So how should we do it?
Well, actually, I just wanted to say that I enjoyed a lot of the talks and a lot of the guest speakers that you guys were able to bring in. I thought that was awesome. I do enjoy that we have the pavilion available to us this year. So there was a lot of really positive things that I felt like, wow, this was really well done. And I know it takes a lot of collaboration and a lot of ideas from you guys to be able to pull it off. So for me, I'm just thankful that you guys volunteered and did all of this. So thanks.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. Much appreciated.
Thanks. What about your ideas for the scheduling?
Okay, I've already voiced this, but since others haven't heard it and maybe been able to comment on it, I did feel that the schedule of the classes took up the entire day. So, like, if you wanted to go eat lunch, like, I actually went to my camper, quick made peanut butter and jelly and came back here at 8, or made a salad and came back here at 8. I would have loved, like, a window so families could eat lunch and maybe go dip in them late before attending another class. And maybe some time set aside so people could have dinner and then come attend a class. Because it seems like from morning till night, everything was scheduled. So I had to give up some of the things I wanted to participate in so that I could actually eat and spend some time with my family.
Yeah. I think that's a great idea. Now, Lynn, what do you think would work better? Are you thinking if we shorten the events so they don't take up the entire time slot, or leave a time slot for intermission? What do you think would work best for you?
In my mind, I thought that if there was intermission, like where you would say from noon to 1:30, we're taking a break, the next session or whatever will be at 1:30, and then like even to say from 5 to 6:30, because then it's not just eating, we get to actually socialize and see people and talk to someone that might have been speaking, or you know, like communicate more with the community instead of just sitting and listening. So I think that would add value for me.
Or talks around. Oh, I can speak loud.
The microphone can't pick you up if you speak loud.
You won't be recorded if you.
Okay. Yeah. We'll another thing, while he's coming up here, I was thinking with maybe the last talk or two of the night could be down at the beach. It's such a nice spot down there. We got a fire down there too. So
you could just move the talks like around like dinner time, lunch time, just the spontaneous order. Because we still had a lot of attendance last year. Whenever we were eating, at any time of day, we still have down at that time. So. I don't think you wouldn't have to cut into the talk time. Just take the pavilion off for an hour.
That's a good idea.
Yeah. Maybe more like discussion types or casual type talks could be over there during dinner time.
Yeah.
I like the idea of going down to the beach, so.
I thought one of the yoga sessions was going to be at the beach.
I guess not. Yeah. I know that yesterday Chris Wines suggested that we have more microphones. Somehow if we had that available, it would be easier for talking when we had to pass them around.
So that is some feedback that we'll have to give Circle Pines. Also,
or we would provide
our own.
Yeah, I don't know how. Maybe we'll have to look into the audio system.
That was interesting. I was given a suggestion on Joe Mouchard, who had left. And one of his suggestions was that we had a mobile PA system with Bluetooth capabilities. So whether we were here or at the spontaneous order tent or anywhere else, sorry, I'm not going to be recorded, that we had a mobile Bluetooth PA system. I have no idea how much that cost, but that was worded. And so that's something, if microphones and the ability to broadcast is important, it might be something we look at.
Yeah, so one thing, this is some of the stuff is, are things that we could begin to acquire with some of the fees that are associated with camping here. I don't know exactly how we came out.
We are this year. About $840 to be made at the end, so that's money for next year.
So we might be able to get some audio visual equipment.
That's not a lot, just might be good. We're going to have to give some to Circle Pines to reserve. What was the date?
That's looking. Part of the cost for next year.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, next year we have a choice.
Oh, yeah, that's the other thing we have to bring up.
But before we get into that, let's go on. Is there any other feedback?
No.
I think it'd be nice if we were a little more proactive in nailing down some food vendors for next year, because we had some people that we were expecting that dropped out near the last minute. So
yeah, I dropped the ball on that one. I mean, I was coordinating food vendors, but there was a lot of uncertainty about when people were going to be here, whether they were going to end up vending food. So we decided to go
just free for all style. And yeah, I didn't eat anything until early today. I had like 7 hot dogs. So yeah, that could be done a lot better next year. I totally agree.
One thing I wanted to bring up is maybe we could start, you know, monthly or bi-monthly meetings now, and anybody that might be interested. It's kind of a lot of work, so if we, you know, the sooner we start, like we're starting today, I think make it a lot easier and, you know, maybe a better planned event next year.
Do we have any other feedback from you guys, any other questions, ideas, or thoughts?
Positive or negative?
Yeah.
So we can repeat the good things as well.
So, okay, for food vending, is there an additional cost, or could we just come, like I'm thinking, doing a big coffee pot, having cups out, honor system? I really don't want the obligation of having to have stuff all the time, fully stocked. But yet, I feel like, oh, I could put out some goodies and some coffee and people just donate. Like, that's something I'm willing to do, but would you not consider that a vendor? And so I just kind of need to know a little more information.
So we've never done anything formally as far as like charging vendors or anything. We just encourage people to come and vend.
I appreciate that, and it makes it more likely that I'll do it, and I will commit to doing it every single day.
Yeah, maybe we need to communicate that better, that we're just, right. It's just...
We're free to bend.
Yeah, we encourage that, everybody.
You need a license.
Strongly encourage that.
Because sometimes if you're going to bend, they would say, well, we're going to put all the vendors in this one area, because maybe it doesn't... Makes sense to have
the tyranny and oppression of Pork Fest.
You know, actually,
right. I'm not necessarily saying that.
We had some discussion on that, and actually, after we talked about it, we decided that we would allow the vendors to just choose their own location, and kind of like the free market would choose the best location to put a business. A vendor here could also do the same.
Well, if somebody's staying in the cabin and wants to do their own coffee and rolls or whatever, that would be great, because then people that are near the cabins would take advantage of that. Or
somebody could bend at right here.
Yeah. So it just depends what level of commitment and where they want to be. But I appreciate that. That's just like a little more that I needed to know personally.
I think donation transactions are more encouraged because of the loophole. So
donations and transactions are encouraged.
Stick to donations, allude to the price if you want to. You know,
donations of X are highly encouraged.
Yeah. Right, recommended donations.
Yeah.
And I think just to go along with that is just if you do decide to vend, if you want us or you want people to know about it, Facebook especially seems to be the place where people are looking for that info. So a lot of times you would see posts in the event from one of us posing a question, and it was more to try and get some feedback on, are people going to do this? Do they want to participate in that way? So be on the lookout for those things, because that is how people know that they exist, you know? As well as maybe if people are vending next year and they're in the apple orchard, I have no concept of who's vending and what they have to sell in the apple orchard if they don't have a sign or they don't talk about it, you know? So maybe we kind of collectively figure out a way for that to be a little more...
To help promote all the
knowledge.
Yeah, that was the thing. We wanted to know who was vending, just not to stop you or tell you you had to be in a certain area, but so we could give you some free advertising.
And we like to buy your stuff. We're hungry. And sometimes you have cool, you know, whatever, jewelry or t-shirts. Or whatever the deal is.
If 5 people say they're going to be selling coffee, then maybe it's the 6th one won't.
Right.
I wasn't planning on vending this year, but I had extra food and meals, so I sort of wound up vending. I did everything donation-based. I didn't even do a suggestion. And I don't think that anybody shortchanged me or went below what I thought it was worth. And obviously, by the amount that they gave, they felt that it was worth it. So I think that works out pretty well. As far as licensing goes, BibCat.
Yeah.
BibCat. Thanks for looking in the other way when I snitched some bacon from you. I didn't have the upper hand on me.
So
where's my wallet?
We do have a question that we would like to pose to you guys. Next year, this weekend is not available. So we have 2 weekends to pick from, and it is the last weekend in August.
Okay, Labor Day is the next weekend.
And then the following weekend is Labor Day weekend. There's been some discussion in our group, and we were unable to come to a consensus on this. Some people do family events on Labor Day. A lot of family events on Labor Day aren't as hard as like an Easter or a Christmas or a Thanksgiving. Some families are more flexible on that. On the other hand, people are off work for a longer period of time on that holiday. If you have kids in school, in Michigan at least, that is a holiday weekend. And so I guess we're just throwing it out there. Maybe we do show of hands. Which weekend you prefer, or if you're indifferent. So there'll be three, the August, Labor Day, or...
Week before Labor Day, Labor Day, the weekend before Labor Day, Labor Day, or you don't care.
All right, all those in favor of the weekend before Labor Day.
Am I counting?
Looks like nine, all those in favor of the weekend of Labor Day. Looks like three. Well, that would be clear. What's that?
All those who don't care.
How about those who abstain from voting?
Yeah, all those.
Healed in its tyranny.
All those who abstain, don't raise your hand. Yeah.
So.
You don't care, shrug?
Yes.
It looks like we will lose the Brewers on Labor Day and lose the Woodses.
Oh my gosh, if we could like have some sort of arm wrestling fest.
But it looks like most people would prefer to have it in August.
Is everybody cool with this space? I mean, we skipped past the obvious question. I mean, everyone's cool with being here at Circle Pines.
Do we still want to do it here?
I would say unless there's a better idea.
Unless there's a better idea real soon, I think we should just take the date, give them some money, and go with this place. That's my opinion.
Does anyone else have an alternate venue they'd like to suggest?
No.
What are you guys talking about?
Oh, the alternative, you know?
Go back to Brighton?
No.
Yeah, I didn't think so.
No, nobody wants to go back to Brighton.
No.
I want to go back to Brighton.
We got to do this there.
I think just from a planning standpoint, it's just easier, and everybody likes it, and it's not broke.
This is a much shorter drive for us.
Yeah, I think that problem is solved. Another question, the pavilion. We had the pavilion this year. We didn't have it last year. It cost us $400 extra. Do you guys think it was worth it?
Yeah. I do. I like it. If we use
I've got no's, yes, and yes. Let's get some commentary. Who wants to give their opinion on Mike?
I will.
I want to give my opinion first, too, since I am Mike. I think we should, my main thing about getting the pavilion was in case it rains, so I think we should definitely keep the pavilion. But as far as having the tots here as opposed to the tent, that's debatable. But it was nice to be here. We got the PA system. We were able to film easier. We had electricity. There were certain advantages to it, but it would have been cool to be in the tent like we were last year, too. So that's my opinion.
I'd say it was six in one hand, half dozen in the other, you know. It's like, it kind of spread things out a little bit, but it was a little bit more formal, kind of, and like nicer up here than the tent. So, you know, that was kind of nice, especially for the TV production and everything.
Yeah, we did have
give that to James.
I was thinking about talks, doing them, you know, just, I think they should be going both places simultaneously.
I
think maybe if we had enough content for that, but at that point, people need to choose between things, and I've been to conventions like that, and it's tons of fun to have options, but then I leave every year like, oh, I really want to do that, and I missed it.
You know, we almost had Alt Expo come to this fest. They expressed interest. it's possible that they could express interest next year. And if that happened, then we would end up with two talks going at the same time.
I think, you know, we should keep them in one spot if we have the same amount of talks we had this year, and try to maybe leave breaks for lunch. And, you know, maybe if we do have more talks available next year, maybe theme a certain theme here and more of a different theme at the tent. So I think that's just going to depend on interest in next year, where how we do it. I guess the question, if we don't have that many talks, we want to primarily here or primarily in the tent.
Anybody else?
Go ahead.
So other than rain protection, I felt like it was very cool in here. We could spread out. I felt like there was a lot less distractions here, because when you're at the campground and at the fire, there's a lot going on, and sometimes it gets difficult when you want to pay attention, but there's so much going on. So I actually appreciated this being a short walk away. And, you know, then I got to see more of the campground, and I think people that are spread out and maybe staying in the cabins kind of appreciated some of the things being closer. So that's my two cents. But I appreciated having the space.
Brandon, come on down.
See, here's the thing. I agree with what you just said a lot, too. That was a way to point that out. I agree 100%. But on the like taking breaks or whatever, or whether or not we should have multiple talks or whatever, I don't think we should put any restraints on talks, because if it's a full schedule, then you say, okay, we're going to take a break. Well, like Jeff said, well, the first thing you have to ask is, well, who are you going to cut? One person or two, or everybody down a little bit, you know? So, I mean, you just kind of have to pick and choose which ones you're gonna see, you know? Like, I mean, all taking a break is doing is saying, no one can give a talk at this point, you know? Well, you know,
I agree with both you guys, and I guess what I would say is that we have the amount of speakers we had this year, we probably could have tried to, I guess we should maybe schedule those lunch and dinner times last, you know, try to leave them out, and if people want to jump in and do something at the last minute, or, you know, we, you know, this is anarchy, we just got to play it by ear, I guess.
Yeah, we can feel it.
But,
we can feel
but it I like your suggestions, and after listening to you, I do think I like this would be the primary speaking area, and maybe if we have too many people, we can use a spontaneous order or even the beach.
Yeah, and plus, if we get all decks, they'll probably bring their own location.
It sounded earlier like there was some people who were against the pavilion. Did anyone who?
Yeah.
Yeah, Steve, come on up.
Anti-pavilion.
Well, he's walking. I was against the pavilion beforehand. It seems to have worked out, in my opinion, so I say keep it, but let's see what Steve says.
No, I know it's a little more formal, and that's kind of why I come to an event like this, is because I'm not a real formal person, so I kind of like the whole camping experience. I feel like I'm a little more spontaneous order tent. I just kind of liked it. It's easier to get back and forth, too, and I do understand what she's saying. But, it's certainly more quiet over here. It's a little bit easier to have maybe a decent conversation or something like that over here. But if you pay $400 for the pavilion, you're probably taking $400 to just put into a little personal PA system, and we could probably get the same idea over there.
Yeah, I would gauge that on how high registration is to begin with, and whether it's really worth the expense. Because then we are spreading the entire, you know, attendance here kind of thin. If, you know, any on like a smaller attendance day, we're all split half and half across the camp. It just seems a lot more condensed whenever it's just the time.
I would say to keep the pavilion just in case it rains. If it rains, we move everything over here. People can hang out here during the holidays. We don't know what it's going to be like next year. And after listening to you, I'm thinking, if you want to do a talk next year, and you say, I'd prefer to do it in the tent, if we have the tent available, then do it in the tent. And if you want to do it in the pavilion, do it in the pavilion. This is whatever everybody wants.
I'm going to say that that's actually what we did this year. I asked every speaker, where do you want to do your presentation?
and they all chose the pavilion. Except for Stephanie, who chose the tent to do her yoga in the grass. And I actually had I held it up in the air with Jason and Tracy for quite a while as to where did they want to do theirs, because they were doing a demonstration, and an advantage for them taking the tent might have been less time restriction, because I was doing 1 hour slots for the pavilion, and I would have gotten something longer for the tent, and they chose the pavilion. So the speakers all independently chose the pavilion this year.
I think that's a good way to do it.
Elizabeth has something to ask.
I just wanted to ask what the percent of the revenue, the cost of the pavilion would be. So like of the amount of money that you guys made this year, what percent of it would be the $400? And also, can I please have a moment to let my children say something, please?
Yeah.
Sure.
All
right.
You shot.
What's your name?
Molly Wolf Woods.
Say it again.
Thanks, guys.
All right, Bruce, could you address her question? Are you doing the math real quick?
So the total expenses for this year was actually $2,720.
That was our total expenses.
That was the total expenses, and the pavilion cost $400.
All right, I think she's asking for net revenues, not total expenses.
So net revenue was about $800, a little more.
Okay, so it would have been $1,200 or so if we not had the pavilion. So that's what we're deciding between here. Elizabeth, you had a follow up?
Yeah.
So if you have $800 and you're going to spend $400 for the pavilion, that's half your budget of what you have to put into next year, you know. And if it costs $2,700 or whatever, you need more than $800 to pay for it. So I mean, it's something to think about.
Just kind of a side question. I mean, I wasn't here for a lot of the talks. I tried to get down here for, you know, the ones that were really kind of grabbing my attention. But so other people would know the answer this way better than I would. What was the turnout differential? I mean, I thought I saw more people in the tent last year, but maybe we just had more people at the event. I thought for the talks I was here at, I thought there were more people gathering at the tent than what I saw here at the pavilion when I was present.
So I was at the majority of the talks as I organized a lot of people, getting people here, and wanted to make sure that they were getting filmed and people were able to get on the microphone when they're asking their questions. Every talk was different. We had some talks that had a pretty small audience. The audience that we have now are, I don't know if you're an audience anymore, but discussion. This is probably about the average for the talks. This would be pretty cramped in the spontaneous order tent, actually. This would have the tent packed in. We would have just been standing outside in the grass for the Kokesh talk had we not had this. We probably had twice as many people in here as what would fit in the spontaneous order tent for the Kokesh talk.
Yeah, I wasn't sure until I heard Lynn, but I think it is better here.
Do we know the cost to join this co-op?
Actually, that's something we just found out. They had memberships this weekend, so that's something we wanted to look into. Did anyone make the 8 o'clock History of Circle Pines lecture last night? Because I missed it.
Because I would just like to say, I don't know that information, but like, I feel very strongly about this place, and if they asked us to join the co-op, then if we have the money to do so, it might be something that I think would be beneficial for many people in the long run. And I also think that the people who own this place value and respect and have many of similar philosophies. So, okay, that's all.
I got a beer belly.
I got a dirty belly.
Thank you for the translation.
Yeah. And marshmallows.
Okay. Yeah. Yay.
Yay.
One advantage of the pavilion is I think it's made it a lot easier to film, you know, the events, to do video, right? If we had to do that in the spontaneous order tent, we wouldn't have power, or at least as easily.
Well, then you would be relying on the quality of the roof of the tent in the event of a storm. I don't think we hesitated at all about leaving our electronics in here, regardless of what the weather was. Very sturdy structure. And nothing short of a hurricane is going to get your electronics equipment right in here.
So what I'm hearing is maybe it's not an either or. Maybe we utilize the tent a little bit more next year, encourage that, just so there's more community. People who need to cook or who are chasing after dogs or children are a little closer to their campsite but can still interact, but yet we have this space, especially if someone's going to want to use audiovisual. Does that make sense?
Certainly, and also last year, we had other types of events that took place in the spontaneous order tent that we could have done this year and we didn't, and I actually put it in the program a couple of times. It was bonfire and bring your games to the spontaneous order tent,
right.
And no one brought any games. Maybe we could acquire some, or maybe communicate more with people.
Do you want to talk, Miss Elizabeth?
I think we could have a dance party here.
We could have a dance.
We could totally do that because this place is used for that, for their summer campers. I seen some pictures and it looks pretty awesome.
Awesome.
You know, Murray Rothbard's parents met at an anarchist ball in like the 20s or something. Look at that, the anarchist ball is going to be next Saturday. Next year, Saturday night, we'll have the anarchist ball.
Right. Anarchist ball.
So, I noticed that this year,
it happened to me earlier, it's not you.
So I noticed that this year is pretty exclusive to ANCAPs and volunteers. We didn't really have as many people from outside of that intent as we did last year. I was wondering if we do have a target demographic, or if we're... Because I mean, if you come here, you look around, just looking at black and yellow everywhere. I'm wondering, are we taking it in that direction to where we just want to be mainly volunteers? Camp out, or are we trying to open it up to all anti-state beliefs?
So if you're anti-state, or if you're voluntarians to our anti-state, we have been black and yellow since the very first fact.
But red and black was very well represented. I mean, there were plenty of red and black, but red and black chose not to come this year, I think can't help that if someone chooses not to come, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think we want everyone to be welcome and to feel welcome. Everyone who's pro-liberty and about taking more empowerment in their own lives.
Yeah,
I think we did probably, you know, we probably could have used more help on promoting the event. We probably didn't do as much promotion as we did. You know, we each did what we felt we were comfortable doing, but we could definitely use more help promoting, and that's what I was hoping to get people start on the planning
page
to help out.
But yes, most of the people who buy the stuff are yellow and black, so
yeah.
That's what happens.
So when it comes to, as far as, you know, anyone is welcome to come, but I think that we are primarily an organization that supports free market anarchy. That's
free market anarchy. Yeah. Limited to anarcho-capitalism.
Still getting an opposition. There you go.
Yeah. But, James is welcome to
anything you, anybody,
on top of that, though, I think a lot of those were, a lot of the talks were preaching to the choir. You'd have a few people in the crowd who weren't as familiar with everything, but for the most part, you know, a lot of it just a little bit more stimulating when you do have opposing views and they're all just trying to reach common ground on them.
I got a lot out of his talks and opened my perspective a little bit.
Yeah, I think there's a few people out in Detroit that already are grouped together that wouldn't be too hard to pull out here at least, or at least get to a few MPLC makes. The name is so open-ended to begin with, the only thing. Unless you find Liberty controversial, then I don't know. Just had a lot more people who were already knew everything that there was to know about most of us coming into it.
And somehow I think that's part of the beauty of the experience too, though, are that people are coming here sometimes for the first time and going, wow, other people believe what I believe. Mm-hmm. I already thought what I was going to say, so at this point it would just be stupid.
Right, you already did the wrestling.
But it came up here to ask, what about the roads? Like maybe then Jason discussed doing road signs, or maybe like they do it in Europe and some places in Japan by blocks, because you could use blocks like the cabin block or this particular block of trees that people are around, as far as helping people get around this place.
Yeah. Okay. So coming up with better like marking for where things are, and
As far as direction of where to people, where to send people, we could also have like a chalkboard and chalk markers, you know, and have a spontaneous order tent be just whoever puts their name down volunteers. We've got an open spot. This is where the open spots are helping keep this for people, like we said, who need slides and whatnot.
I like that idea.
We were also scheduling stuff.
Spontaneous order can be spontaneous.
Right, right. As well as scheduled.
Pirate princess party.
Well, I just think that all Expo, if they were interested in paying, this might address what Kip was talking about, because they do bring a lot of different topics too. And, you know, I've been to these events for 3 years, and I learn a lot every time, because I still feel like I'm very new to the movement and very removed when I'm at home. So coming here gets me, like, new things to think about, new people to be in touch with. So it wasn't preaching to the choir to me, and I think there's Kip, and so he missed my comment. I was just saying that if Alt Expo came, that might address some needs of not necessarily preaching to the choir, because they bring a lot of different ideas to the table.
What's that one place called in Detroit? Trumbleplex?
Trumbleplex.
Trumbleplex. Reach out.
Sure. Yeah, definitely. I think the MPLC did an event there at one point, a couple years ago.
I have another topic for discussion. What did you guys think about the programs?
I thought mine were really good.
The programs?
The printed program.
Oh, yeah. Printed program.
Did you find that useful, helpful?
Yeah,
helpful?
Yes.
Yeah,
I needed that.
The math did have.
Math could be better.
Yeah, the map could be better.
The map could be better, and I was going to say, if you would take that thing and walk around and do that again, and then add the road names or the block names, whatever we decide to do. I definitely like to do signage, but I'd need help coming up with materials, but I'd definitely be up for volunteering time to.
Thank you.
Yeah.
The Zelda style was cool.
Name tags. I think last year we had them, and when you pulled in, you kind of got all 20.
We had
them here, but you weren't here, and then people didn't take them.
Yeah, we kept trying to get people to take the name tags.
Okay. I thought they were last year. We handed out when we pulled in.
So yeah.
That's what we need to do.
Having more obvious signage for that. Concerning the programs,
I would suggest no rock climbing pictures. It's going to be rock climbing. That is all.
Let the kid talk.
Oh.
Gavin was drawn in heel on the ground over in somewhere rock where we go in.
He was drawn on the ground somewhere, his brother.
Awesome.
That sounds like a lot of fun. That sounds like a vote
were
for the pavilion.
Okay,
brother. I'll take a point. Thank you.
Thank
you, buddy. All right,
just things and details, and definitely have to add more.
Getting back to the pavilion, we've had some discussion, we've had to talk about it. Just a show of hands to see who's for the pavilion next year and who. All right, these are people that are for. Okay. Four. All right. Who's against the pavilion next year?
I don't know that I'm against the pavilion. But
think that the money could be spent more wisely. Put your hand up. What are you, some kind of rebel? No. Good. I'm just saying. I was just thinking it would be instructive for whoever's planning it next year to have kind of a guide on what people thought about it at this meeting. So
the value of it.
I don't hate the pavilion.
I think you have some very, very good concerns, and Elizabeth too. I mean, $400 is pretty steep for what we got out of it.